welcome back to Stories to Explore Children. I'm Anne Marie. I have another Beatrix Potter for you. And in this one, there are going to be some words that you may not know because they're British. And actually, some of them actually are used in the United States but haven't been for a little while. And then I'm going to also explain the old form of British money, the farthings and the pennies and the hay pennies and so forth. So, this story today, my first story, is The Tale of Ginger and Pickles by Beatrix Potter. Once upon a time, there was a village shop. The name over the window was Ginger and Pickles. It was a small shop, just the right size for dolls, Lucinda and Jane doll. They always bought their groceries at Ginger and Pickles. Now, do you remember, children, who was Lucinda and Jane? Who were Lucinda and Jane? Do you remember? That's right. In the last story, they were the dolls who lived in the fancy dollhouse that the two bad mice went into and ransacked and stole all sorts of little things for their hole, little pots and pans and a quilt. The counter inside was a convenient height for rabbits. Ginger and Pickles sold red, spotty pocket handkerchiefs at a penny, three farthings. Well, a penny, three farthings today would be 1 cent in American money today. They also sold sugar, snuff, and galoshes. Now, snuff is a form of tobacco. And in our next story, you will see Samuel Whiskers, who's mentioned this story, taking a little bit of snuff. It was kept in a little tin, and gentlemen would take a little bit of it and they would sort of push it up in their nose and it would make them sneeze. And I don't know if cigarettes had been invented then. But snuff was used by mostly British gentlemen. Sugar, snuff, and galoshes. Now galoshes are a type of boot that go over your shoes and it's sort of a soft rubber and it had a little button on the side that would attach around your ankle. In fact, although it was such a small shop, it sold nearly everything, bootlaces, hairpins, tea towels. Ginger and Pickles were the people who kept the shop. And notice that Beatrice refers to them as people, but of course their true identity is as animals, as a cat and a dog. Ginger was a yellow tomcat and Pickles was a terrier. The rabbits were always a little bit afraid of Pickles. And the shop was also patronized by mice, but the mice were rather afraid of Ginger. Ginger usually requested Pickles to serve them because he said it made his mouth water, because of course cats go after mice. "I cannot bear," said he, "to see them going out at the door carrying their little parcels." "I have the same feeling about rats," replied Pickles, "but it would never do to eat our own customers. They would leave us and go to Tabitha Twitchett's." "On the contrary, they would go nowhere," replied Ginger gloomily. Tabitha Twitchett kept the only other shop in the village. She did not give credit. Now, do you remember Tabitha Twitchett, children? Who was Tabitha Twitchett? This is I believe it was the story a few stories ago. Oh, that's right. Tabitha Twitchett had served a luncheon. It was her intention to serve a luncheon of mouse pie, and the pie pans got all mixed up by her guest, and it was the story called The Pie and the Patty Pan, if you remember that one. That was Tabitha Twitchett's house. Now, Ginger and Pickles gave unlimited credit. Now, the meaning of credit is this. When a customer buys a bar of soap, instead of the customer pulling out a purse and paying for it, she says she will pay another time later on. And Pickles makes a low bow and says, "With pleasure, madam," and it is written down in a book. The customers come again and again and buy quantities in spite of being afraid of Ginger and Pickles, but there is no money in what is called the till. The till is the cash box. The customers came in crowds every day and bought quantities, especially the toffee customers, but there was always no money. They never paid for as much as a penny worth of peppermints. But the sales were enormous, 10 times as large as Tabitha Twitchett's. And as there was always no money, Ginger and Pickles were obliged to eat their own goods. Pickles ate biscuits, and Ginger ate a dried haddock. And you see Ginger there, and she's eating just like an ordinary cat. They ate them by candlelight after the shop was closed, which is easy to understand, children. They thought it would be embarrassing, after all, to eat their own goods. When it came to January 1st, there was still no money, and Pickles was unable to buy a dog license. "Well, it's very unpleasant. I'm afraid of the police," said Pickles. "Well, it's your own fault for being a terrier. I do not require a license, and neither does Kep the collie dog." So I guess terriers' children must have been considered maybe a little more dangerous, that they had to have a license. "It is very uncomfortable. I'm afraid I shall be summoned. I have tried in vain to get a license upon credit at the post office," said Pickles. "The place is full of policemen. I met one as I was coming home." "Well, let us send in the bill again to Samuel Whiskers, Ginger. He owes 22.9 for bacon." Now that would be, children, 22 shillings and 9 pence, which today in dollars would be $1.70. Oh, how do I know all this, by the way? Well, I have a friend in London, and I emailed him, and he told me all of these, gave me all this information. "I do not believe that he intends to pay at all," replied Ginger. "And I am sure that Anna Maria pockets things. Where are all the cream crackers?" "You've eaten them yourself," replied Ginger. Now you may say, what in the world is, how can a cracker be creamy? Well, a cream cracker, actually you can buy these in all the grocery stores in the United States. And it's a cracker that's made of very, very fine flour, so it's very flaky, very soft. Ginger and Pickles then retired into the back parlor. They did accounts. They added up sums and sums and sums. "Well, Samuel Whiskers has run up a bill as long as his tail. He's had 1 ounce and 3 quarters of snuff since October. Now, what is 7 pounds of butter at 1 and 3? That's 1 shilling and 3 pence, 9 cents today. 7 pounds of butter at 1 and 3 and a stick of sealing wax at 4 matches? "Oh, send in all the bills again to everybody with compliments," replied Ginger. After a time, they heard a noise in the shop as if something had been pushed in at the door. They came out of the back parlor. There was an envelope lying on the counter and a policeman writing in a notebook. Pickles nearly had a fit. He barked and he barked and he made little rushes, kind of running at the policeman. "Bite him, Pickles, bite him," spluttered Ginger behind a sugar barrel. "He's only a German doll." The policeman went on writing in his notebook. Twice he put his pencil in his mouth, and once he dipped it in the trickle. Now, why would anyone put a pencil in their mouth, children? Well, in the old days, the pencils weren't like they are today, and they had to sometimes be moistened to get a dark line on the paper. And treacle, I believe, is some sort of a sweet, I think it's some sort of a sauce. Pickles barked till he was hoarse, but still the policeman took no notice. He had bead eyes, and his helmet was sewn on with stitches. Now, children, where did we last hear about a policeman doll? That is correct. Lucinda and Jane wanted to get a policeman doll for their dollhouse after the two bad mice went in there and broke everything up and stole things. At length, on his last little rush, Pickles found that the shop was empty. The policeman had disappeared, but the envelope remained. "Oh, well, do you suppose he's gone to fetch a real live policeman? I'm afraid it's a summons," said Pickles. "No, no," replied Ginger, who had opened the envelope. "It is the rates and taxes, L3, 19, 11 and 3 quarters. So children, that's 3 pounds, 19 shillings, 11 pence, three farthings, which would be $6 in today's money. But back then, my friend told me, it was about $20, which is a fair amount of money almost at the turn of the century in England for a dog and a cat to be paying taxes like that. "This is the last straw," said Pickles. "Let us close the shop." They put up the shutters and left, but they have not removed from the neighborhood. In fact, some people wish they had gone further. Ginger is living in the Warren. I do not know what occupation he pursues, but he looks stout and comfortable. Pickles, at present, is a gamekeeper. The closing of the shop caused great inconvenience. Tabitha Twitchett immediately raised the price of everything a half penny, and she continued to refuse to give credit. Of course, there are the tradesmen's carts. There's the butcher, the fishman, and Timothy Baker. But a person cannot live on seed wigs and sponge cake and butter buns, not even when the sponge cake is as good as Timothy's. Seed wig, children. Well, a seed wig is a little small bun made with a special type of flour, a seed wig. After a time, Mr. John Dormouse and his daughter began to sell peppermints and candles. But they did not keep self-fitting sixes. Now, that's a type of candle, children, a six-inch candle. And it takes five mice to carry one seven-inch candle. And the candles, which they sell, behave very strangely in warm weather. And Miss Dormouse refused to take back the ends when they were brought back to her with complaints. When Mr. John Dormouse was complained to, he stayed in bed and would say nothing but very snug, which is certainly not the way to carry on a retail business. So everybody was very pleased when Sally Henny Penny sent out a printed poster to say that she was going to reopen the shop. Henny's opening sale, Grand Cooperative Jumble. Penny's penny prices, come buy, come try, and come buy. The poster was really most enticing. And there was a rush upon opening day. The shop was crammed with customers, and there were crowds of mice upon the biscuit canisters. Sally Henny Penny gets rather flustered when she tries to count out change, and of course she insists on being paid cash, but she really is quite harmless. And she has laid in a remarkable assortment of bargains. Why, there's something to please everybody. And that's the story of Ginger and Pickles. So children, I'll be right back with another story. You stay right where you are. Maybe you want to get yourself a cup of tea, which is what Beatrix Potter would have liked to drink. And I'll be right back. Well, children, I'm back with another story. And this one is The Tale of Samuel Whiskers. Now, you remember that name? He had run up a big bill at Ginger and Pickles. And actually, this story is really more about Tom Kitten, but it is entitled by Beatrix Potter, The Tale of Samuel Whiskers. Once upon a time, there was an old cat called Mrs. Tabitha Twitchett, you remember that name, who was an anxious mother. She used to lose her kittens continually, and whenever they were lost, they were always in mischief. So on baking day, she determined to shut them up in a cupboard. She had caught Moppet and Mittens, but she could not find Tom. Mrs. Tabitha went up and down all over the house, mewing for Tom Kitten. She looked in the pantry under the staircase, and she searched the best spare bedroom that was all covered up with dust sheets. She went right upstairs and looked into the attics, but she could not find him anywhere. It was an old, old house full of cupboards and passages. Some of the walls were 4 feet thick and used to have queer noises inside them, as if there might be little secret staircases. Certainly there were odd little jagged doorways in the wainscot, and things disappeared at night, especially cheese and bacon. Mrs. Tabitha became more and more distracted and mewed dreadfully. While their mother was searching the house, Moppet and Mittens had gotten into mischief. You see, the cupboard was not locked, so they pushed open the cupboard door and came out. They went straight to the dough, which was set to rise in a pan before the fire. They patted it with their little soft paws. "Shall we make dear little muffins?" said Mittens to Moppet. Just at that moment, somebody knocked on the front door, and Moppet jumped into the flour barrel in a fright. Mittens ran away to the dairy and hid in an empty jar on the stone shelf where the milk pans stand. The visitor was a neighbor, Mrs. Ribby. She had called to borrow some yeast. Now, Mrs. Ribby, a few stories ago, Mrs. Ribby had a luncheon at her house where she served mouse pie, or so she thought, because there was a mix-up of pans, because the dog whom she invited didn't want to eat mouse and tried to switch the pans around in the oven. The story was called The Tale of the Pie and the Patty Pan. That was at Mrs. Ribby's house. Mrs. Tabitha came downstairs, mewing dreadfully. "Oh, come in, Cousin Ribby, come in, and will you sit ye down? I'm in sad trouble, Cousin Ribby," said Tabitha, shedding tears. "I've lost my dear son Thomas. I'm afraid the rats have got him." She wiped her eyes with her apron. "He's a bad kitten, Cousin Tabitha. He made a cat's cradle out of my best bonnet last time I came to tea." "Well, where have you looked for him?" "All over the house. The rats are too many for me. Oh, what a thing it is to have an unruly family," said Mrs. Tabitha Twitchit. "I'm not afraid of cats. I will help you to find him, and whip him too. What's all that soot on the fender?" Now, a fender is the outer edge of a fireplace. "Well, the chimney wants sweeping. Oh, dear me, Cousin Ribby, now Moppet and Mittens are gone. They've both gotten out of the cupboard." Ribby and Tabitha set to work to search the house thoroughly again. They poked under the beds with Ribby's umbrella, and they rummaged in the cupboards. They even fetched a candle and looked inside a clothes chest in one of the attics. They could not find anything, but once they heard a door bang and somebody scuttered downstairs. "Oh, yes, yes, it's infested with rats," said Tabitha tearfully. "I caught 7 young ones coming out of one hole in the back kitchen, and we had them for dinner last Saturday. And once I saw the old father rat, an enormous old rat, Cousin Ribby, I was just going to jump on him when he showed me his yellow teeth that he whisked down the same old hole." "The rats get upon my nerves, Cousin Ribby," said Tabitha. Ribby and Tabitha searched and searched. They both heard a curious roly-poly noise under the attic floor, but there was nothing to be seen. They returned to the kitchen. "Well, here's one of your kittens at last," said Ribby, dragging Moppet out of the flour barrel. They shook the flour off her and set her down on the kitchen floor. She seemed to be in a terrible fright. "Oh, Mother, Mother," said Moppet, "there's been an old woman rat in the kitchen, and she's stolen some of the dough." The two cats ran to look at the dough pan. Sure enough, there were marks of little scratching fingers, and a lump of dough was gone. "Well, which way did she go, Moppet?" But Moppet had been much too frightened to peep out of the barrel again. Ribby and Tabitha took her with them to keep her safely in sight while they went on with their search. They went into the dairy. The first thing they found was Mittens hiding in an empty jar. They tipped up the jar, and she scrambled out. "Oh, Mother, Mother," said Mittens. Mother, there's been an old man rat in the dairy, a dreadful, enormous, big rat, Mother, and he's stolen a pat of butter and the rolling pin." Ribby and Tabitha looked at each other. "A rolling pin and butter? Oh, my poor son Thomas!" exclaimed Tabitha, wringing her paws. "Rolling pin?" said Ribby. "Did we not hear a roly-poly noise in the attic when we were looking into that chest?" Ribby and Tabitha rushed upstairs again. Sure enough, the roly-poly noise was still going on quite distinctly under the attic floor. "This is serious, Cousin Tabitha," said Ribby. "We must send for John Joyner at once with a saw." John Joyner was a carpenter. So now we're going to have a flashback, children. Now, this is what had been happening to Tom Kitten, and it shows how very unwise it is to go up a chimney in a very old house where a person does not know his way and where there are enormous rats. Tom Kitten did not want to be shut up in a cupboard. When he saw that his mother was going to bake, he determined to hide. He looked about for a nice, convenient place, and he fixed upon the chimney. The fire had only just been lighted, so it was not yet hot, but there was a white, choky smoke from the green sticks. Tom Kitten got upon the fender and looked up. It was a big, old-fashioned fireplace. The chimney itself was wide enough inside for a man to stand up and walk about, so there was plenty of room for little Tomcat. Tom Kitten took another big jump off the bar and landed on a ledge high up inside the chimney, knocking down some soot into the fender. Well, that's the soot that Ribby asked about. Tom Kitten coughed and choked with the smoke, and he could hear the sticks beginning to crackle and burn in the fireplace down below. He made up his mind to climb right to the top and get out on the slates and try to catch sparrows. I cannot go back. If I slipped, I might fall in the fire and singe my beautiful tail and my little blue jacket. The chimney was a very big, old-fashioned one. It was built in the days when people burnt lots of wood in the hearth. The chimney stack stood up above the roof like a little stone tower, and the daylight shone down from the top under the slanting slates that kept out the rain. Tom Kitten by now was getting very frightened. He climbed up, up, and up. Then he waded sideways through inches of soot. He was like a little sweep himself. Now a sweep, children, you may know this. A sweep is the man, could be a woman, who goes in and cleans the chimneys. It cleans the flue that goes up from the firebox where the wood is and all the way up and into the chimney that goes up above the roof. It was most confusing in the dark. One flue seemed to lead to another. There was less smoke, but Tom Kitten felt quite lost. He scrambled up and up, but before he reached the chimney top, he came to a place where somebody had loosened a stone in the wall. There were some mutton bones lying about. Mutton is cooked sheep meat. "Well, this seems funny," said Tom Kitten. "Who's been gnawing bones up here in the chimney? Oh, I wish I had never come. What a funny smell. It's something like mouse, but dreadfully strong. It makes me sneeze," said Tom Kitten. He squeezed through the hole in the wall and dragged himself along a most uncomfortably tight passage where there was scarcely any light. He groped his way carefully for several yards. It was at the back of the skirting board in the attic, where there is a little mark in this picture. And you'll see it there, children. All at once, he fell head over heels in the dark, down a hole, and landed on a heap of very dirty rags. When Tom Kitten picked himself up and looked around, he found himself in a place that he had never seen before, although he had lived all his life in that house. It was a very small, stuffy, fusty room with boards, rafters, and cobwebs, and lath and plaster. Opposite to him, as far away as he could sit, was an enormous rat. "What do you mean by tumbling into my bed all covered with smuts?" said the rat, chattering his teeth. "Well, please, sir, the chimney wants sweeping," said poor Tom Kitten. Anna Maria, squeaked the rat. There was a pattering noise, and an old woman rat poked her head around a rafter. All in a minute, she rushed upon Tom Kitten, and before he knew what was happening, his coat was pulled off, and he was rolled up in a bundle and tied with string in very hard knots. Anna Maria did the tying. The old rat watched her and took snuff. Now, in the picture, children, you'll see him with his little tin, as I described it during the first story, taking the snuff out to put in his nose. When she had finished, They both sat staring at him with their mouths open. Anna Maria, said the old man rat, whose name was Samuel Whiskers. Anna Maria, make me a kitten dumpling, roly-poly pudding for my dinner. Well, it requires dough and a pat of butter and a rolling pin, said Anna Maria, considering Tom Kitten with her head on one side. No, no, said Samuel Whiskers. Make it properly, Anna Maria, with breadcrumbs. Nonsense, butter and dough, replied Anna Maria. The two rats consulted together for a few minutes and then went away. Samuel Whiskers got through a hole in the wainscot and went boldly down the front staircase to the dairy to get the butter. He did not meet anybody. I guess the lady of the house had her way. He made a second journey for the rolling pin. He pushed it in front of him with his paws, like a brewer's man trundling a barrel of beer. He could hear Ribby and Tabitha talking, but they were busy lighting the candle to look into the chest. They did not see him. Anna Maria went down by way of the skirting board and a window shutter to the kitchen to steal the dough. She borrowed a small saucer and scooped up the dough with her paws. She did not observe Moppet in the flour bin. While Tom Kitten was left alone under the floors of the attic, he wriggled about and tried to mew for help. But his mouth was full of soot and cobwebs, and he was tied up in such very tight knots that he could not make anybody hear him, except the spider, which came out of a crack in the ceiling and examined the knots critically from a safe distance. Of course, it was a judge of knots because it had a habit of tying up unfortunate blue bottle flies. It did not offer any assistance. Tom Kitten wriggled and squirmed until he was quite exhausted. Presently, the rats came back and set to work to make him into a dumpling. First, they smeared him with butter, and then they rolled him in the dough. Will not the string be very indigestible, Anna Maria? Inquired Samuel Whiskers. Anna Maria said she thought that it was of no consequence, but she wished that Tom Kitten would hold his head still as it disarranged the pastry. She laid hold of his ears. Terrible, terrible stories, terrible situation. Tom Kitten bit and spat and mewed and wriggled, and the rolling pin went roly-poly-poly, roly-roly-poly. The cats each held an end. His tail is sticking. You did not fetch enough dough, Anna Maria. I fetched as much as I could carry, replied Anna Maria. I do not think, said Samuel Whiskers, pausing to take a look at Tom Kitten, I do not think it will be a good pudding. It smells sooty. Anna Maria was about to argue the point when all at once there began to be other sounds up above, the rasping noise of a saw and the noise of a little dog scratching and yelping. The rats dropped the rolling pin and listened attentively. We are discovered and interrupted, Anna Maria. Let us collect our property and other people's and depart at once. I fear that we shall be obliged to leave this pudding. But I am persuaded the knots would have proved indigestible, whatever you may have said, thought to the contrary. Come away at once and help me to tie up some mutton bones in a counterpane, said Anna Maria. I've got half a smoked ham hidden in the chimney. So it happened that by the time John Joyner had got the plank up, there was nobody under the floor except the rolling pin and Tom Kitten in a very dirty dumpling. But there was a strong smell of rats, and John Joyner spent the rest of the morning sniffing and whining and wagging his tail and going round and round with his head in the hole like a gimlet. Now, a gimlet is a long tool with a handle, and it's got on the sharp end, it looks like the bit of a drill, but it's something you can use instead of a hand drill with a crank to just quickly turn and grind through the wood to make a hole. Then he nailed the plank down again and put his tools in his bag and came downstairs. The cat family had quite recovered. They invited him to stay to dinner. The dumpling had been peeled off Tom Kitten and made separately into a bag pudding with currants in it to hide the smuts. Now, you see, smuts are bits of dirt. And you may know that currants are much smaller than raisins, and they're dark red, but they're tiny. So when the currants were mixed in there with the dough, if you saw a currant, you didn't know whether it was a currant or a piece of dirt. They had been obliged to put Tom Kitten into a hot bath to get the butter off. John Joyner smelt the pudding, but he regretted that he had not time to stay for dinner, because he had just finished making a wheelbarrow for Miss Potter, our authoress, and she had ordered 2 hen coops. And Miss Potter said, when I was going to the post late in the afternoon, I looked up the lane from the corner and I saw Mr. Samuel Whiskers and his wife on the run with big bundles on a little wheelbarrow, which looked very like mine. They were just turning in at the gate to the barn of Farmer Potatoes. Samuel Whiskers was puffing and out of breath. Anna Maria was still arguing in shrill tones. She seemed to know her way, and she seemed to have a quantity of luggage. I'm sure I never gave her leave to borrow my wheelbarrow. They went into the barn and hauled their parcels up with a bit of string to the very top of the hay mow or the hay stack. And after that, there were no more rats for a long time at Tabitha Twitchett's. As for Farmer Potatoes, he's been driven nearly distracted. There are rats and rats and rats in his barn. They eat up the chicken food. They steal the oats and bran and make holes in the meal bags. And they all descended from Mr. and Mrs. Samuel Whiskers, children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. There is no end to them. But Moppet and Mittens have grown up into very good rat catchers. They go out rat catching in the village, and they find plenty of employment. They charge so much a dozen and earn their living very comfortably. They hang up the rats' tails in a row on the barn door to show how many they have caught. Dozens and dozens. But Tom Kitten has always been afraid of rats. He never durst face anything that is bigger than a mouse. And that's the end of the Tale of Samuel Whiskers. Children, I hope you've enjoyed these stories. Now, if you care to, I'd like you to let me know if you'd like some different sorts of stories. I have permission to read stories from a publisher called Barefoot Books in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And of course, I can continue with the Beatrix Potter because it's not in the public domain and it's free to use and read anywhere someone might like. So thank you for watching. I hope you did get yourself a cup of tea or a glass of milk and that you enjoyed it. I hope you'll be with me next time for Stories to Explore. My name is Anne Marie, and you've been watching me on Norfolk Public Access. So good night, children, and I'll see you the next time.